Blackstone Audio presents Goodbye Darkness, a memoir of the Pacific War by William Manchester. To Robert E. Manchester, brother and brother Marine. Preamble. Blood That Never Dried. Our Boeing 747 has been fleeing westward from darkened California, racing across the Pacific toward the sun, the incandescent eye of God. But slowly, 3 hours later than West Coast time, twilight gathers outside, veil upon lilac veil. This is what the French call l'heure bleue. Aquamarine becomes turquoise, turquoise lavender, lavender violet, violet magenta, magenta mulberry. Seen through my cocktail glass, the light fades as it deepens. It becomes opalescent, crepuscular. In the last waning moments of the day, I can still feel the failing sunlight on my cheek, taste it in my martini. The plane rises before a spindrift. The darkening sky, broken by clouds like combers, boils and foams overhead. Then the whole weight of evening falls upon me. Old memories, phantoms repressed for more than a third of a century, begin to stir. I can almost hear the rhythm of surf on distant snow-white beaches. I have another drink, and then I learn for the 100th time that you can't drown your troubles, not the real ones, because if they are real, they can swim. One of my worst recollections, one I had buried in my deepest memory bank long ago, comes back with a clarity so blinding that I surge forward against the seatbelt, appalled by it, filled with remorse and shame. I am remembering the first man I slew. There was this little hut on Motobu, perched atop a low rise overlooking the East China Sea. It was a fisherman's shack, so ordinary that scarcely anyone had noticed it. I did. I noticed it because I happened to glance in that direction at a crucial moment. The hut lay between us and B Company of the 1st Battalion. Word had been passed that the company had been taking sniper losses. They thought the sharpshooters were in spider holes, Jap foxholes. But as I was looking that way, I saw two B Company guys drop, and from the angle of their fall, I knew the firing had to come from a window on the other side of that hut. At the same time, I saw that the shack had windows on our side, which meant that once the rifleman had B Company pinned down, he could turn toward us. I was dug in with Barney Cobb. We had excellent defilade ahead and the 22nd Marines on our right flank, but we had no protection from the hut, and our hole wasn't deep enough to let us sweat it out. Every time I glanced at that shack, I was looking into the empty eye socket of death. The situation was as clear as the deduction from a Euclidean theorem, but my psychological state was extremely complicated. S.L.A. Marshall once observed that the typical fighting man is often at a disadvantage because he comes from a civilization in which aggression, connected with the taking of life, is prohibited and unacceptable. This was especially true of me, whose horror of violence had been so deep-seated that I had been unable to trade punches with other boys. But since then, life had become cheaper to me. 2,000 pounds of education drops to a 10 rupee, wrote Kipling of the fighting on India's northwest frontier. My plight was not unlike that described by the famous sign in the Paris Zoo. Warning, this animal is vicious. When attacked, it defends itself. I was responding to a basic biological principle first set down by the German zoologist Heini Hediger in his Skizzen zu einer Tierpsychologie und im Zirkus. Hediger noted that beyond a certain distance, which varies from one species to another, an animal will retreat, while within it, it will attack. He called these flight distance and critical distance. Obviously, I was within critical distance of the hut. It was time to bar the bridge, stick a finger in the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.